Well, hey, Cathedral family, really, really excited to look into God's Word with you today. As you saw from the little video there, obviously we're continuing in our series in Ephesians, and so grab hold of your Bible, turn over to Ephesians. I'll meet you there in just a moment. I hope that you're getting some time this summer, or maybe have gotten some time to go on a little vacation, spend some time. Maybe it's here in this city as more and more things have opened up, and you're spending time here, maybe going on a trip. One of the things that we were blessed to do a year ago, you know, your phone will give you those like on this day and show you pictures from like last year. That's like my favorite thing that a phone does. And the other day, it gave us this picture. I've got this picture from Colorado. Last year, we were blessed to go on a month-long sabbatical from ministry and get some time of refreshment. And one of the places that we went was to this, we went on this drive. It's called Million Dollar Highway because there was some, gold rush kind of things that had been done a long time ago. But we drove through the mountains, and there's all of these beautiful switchbacks. I love driving. I love driving fast. Confessions in church. But, you know, one of the things through this area, there's all these switchbacks, and we were driving a 15-passenger van, so it would be foolish for me to drive too fast. It would also be foolish for me to drive fast if I want my wife to ever speak to me again. And, you know, it would be really wise for me to drive carefully through this section if I care about the safety of my family. So I didn't drive super fast through there. And Paul is telling us in this passage today what true wisdom looks like. He's telling us to look carefully, to be careful as we walk this life, to do it with incredible wisdom. And so let's pray together and let's seek the Lord's wisdom as we go to His Word. Father, we are grateful for Your Word and grateful for the way that You instruct us through each and every passage of Scripture. And Lord, we pray that You would use this passage today to give us Your wisdom as we live our lives in a way that honors You. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So, hopefully you got hold of your Bible. We're going to be in Ephesians 5, 15 through 21, and looking at what God tells us here as we live wise lives, if we walk in a way that's wise to Him. So, if you remember, a few weeks ago, we've been talking about, Pastor Jeff shared with us that we're to be who we are. There's these incredible blessings that we see throughout the chapter 5 of Ephesians, that we're to live in a way that reflects who we already are. Because what Jesus has done for us, that we've been purchased, that we've been redeemed, that we've moved from death to life, we've moved from darkness to light, and because of that, we're to live in a way that reflects who we already are. Last week we learned from Paul that we need to wake up. And here today is a call to wise living. Because of who you are, because of what's been done in you, there is a way in which we are to act and live and conduct ourselves, that we're to conduct ourselves according to God's wisdom because of what He's done for us. We're to walk wisely. It's a calling to maturity. He begins this chapter, even chapter 5, verse 1, he calls us beloved children. As you think about the way that children grow in maturity, part of that maturity is turning away from foolishness. I love my kids, but I didn't have to teach them to be foolish. And as I grew up, I didn't have to learn to, my parents are here today, you could ask them, I didn't have to learn to be foolish. I was pretty good at that on my own. But instead, I'm putting wisdom into practice. That's what maturity is. It's making the wise decision even when I feel like doing something else. And so Paul is calling us to maturity in the way in which we walked. First, he's calling us to act wisely. Let's look down at the text, chapter 5, verse 15. Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil. He's telling us to do this carefully. It's the image of, you know, Indiana Jones removing that golden statue carefully and putting the bag of sand there. It's what you're looking for in a surgeon. Careful. Walk carefully. It's walking carefully in the dark so that you don't slam your toe into that little piece on the end of your bed. I think we've probably all done that at some point in our life. And if you've done it, the next few times you get up in the middle of the night to use the bathroom, you will walk very carefully because I don't want that ever to happen to me again. That's what Paul is talking about here. Walk as those who are wise. He's not simply talking about intelligence. He's assuming action. It's to use and to apply the knowledge that I have to get the most out of my life for Jesus Christ. Our actions should be wise so as to, what does he say? To make the best use of the time. We've heard it said that good is the enemy of the best, and to say no to the good so that we can say yes to the best. There is, believer, a best use of your life and of my life. There's a best use of our time, and we must look carefully for what that is. But why? Why, Paul? Why should I make the best use of my time? Why should I make it count? Why should I make the best use? Because the days are evil. The days are evil. They're active in looking for a way to drag us into evil. Our enemy prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he will devour. If you've ever looked at a kid's bedroom, if you've actually looked at my kid's bedroom right now, you know that things move from order to chaos pretty easily. They move from a clean floor to Legos that I'm stepping on each night as I try. That is evil if you've ever stepped on a Lego. They move from order to chaos. It's not magic. It's just the way that things are. You don't need to look for very long at the news or at your Instagram feed or scroll through the comments of Facebook before you realize that the days are evil. They move from order to chaos because these days are evil. And because of that, Paul is calling us here. He's saying the time is now. Make the best use of your days for Jesus Christ. Make every opportunity count because the days are evil. And the time is now to make the mark for Jesus Christ. Now, thankfully, the days won't always be evil. We are told that a day is coming when every wrong will be right, where every injustice will be made right, where God will wipe away every tear. But that's not today. Today, the days are evil, and so we make each and every day count. And what Paul is saying is the wise person, the wise follower of Jesus Christ, will look for every opportunity to make their days count, not just for today, but for all eternity. So the question is, are you making the best use of every opportunity that the Lord has given you? Are you using your life today to display the glory of God? Are you using it to make a difference for Jesus Christ? Listen, don't waste the opportunities that you've been given. You've been placed at that job to be a missionary for Jesus Christ. You've been placed in that condo building to be an ambassador for Christ. You've been placed at that school to be a light for Christ to those who don't know him. You've been given those friends, placed around those people who don't yet know him, so that you could show the difference that following Jesus makes. That's why you have those friends. So don't miss that opportunity. Don't miss the chance. Don't miss the chance that God has placed you right there. So don't waste it on yourself. Don't waste it on the fun that I might have today or my, like we heard, my financial investment and how I'm going to grow in that. And don't waste it in how well I'm going to do at my next race that I'm running. God has placed you there to make a difference for Jesus Christ. And each day, it's evil. So make it count for Jesus Christ. Make the best use of the time that you have, because we only have one opportunity to make it count for Jesus Christ. That is how we act wisely. And we're called to think wisely. Verse 17 then says, "Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is." He's contrasting here wisdom and foolishness. And that's what he's calling it when we don't make the best use of our days. This foolishness can describe both a person who's sort of drawn along by their friends all of the time, drawn along by the crowd, and I'm just sort of floating through life with whatever happens to me and whatever others around me are. Sure, we'll go over there. Sure, we'll do that thing. Sure, I'll participate in that. Just sort of floating around. But it also can refer to the person who's impulse driven, who's following along with their feelings and their wants and their desires. I'm only thinking about what I want right now and what makes me feel good. And yeah, that let's do that. It's also talking about that. You know, I would eat a burger, the Wolf Burger from Little Bad Wolf in Andersonville. Oh my gosh. Four patties, massive amounts of cheese, this garlic aioli they put on it. I'm making all of you hungry right now, right? This bacon and a fried egg on top. I would eat that burger every day of my life. But that would be foolish. I mean, first of all, Dave Ramsey would have a problem with that. My budget would be destroyed. And then second of all, my training program would be ruined. And then I would probably end up in the hospital from all the cholesterol. I mean, it's just a bad idea. But that's what I want. And it would be foolish for me to do that each and every day. But so many of us, that's how we're living our lives. Just driven along by what I want today. And listen, maturity in Jesus Christ is wisdom. It's moving past those things to walk wisely. You know, when we work on sermons together, all of our campus pastors, we get together during the week, and we all open up God's Word, and we're studying this passage today. This passage is being preached live on every one of our campuses. We have a text group where we're texting along some ideas, and I saw this in the text. What do you guys think about this? And I really wanted to call this sermon, "Don't Be Stupid." Maybe I'm the weird one of all the campus pastors. Sorry, you've got me. They didn't go for that. So we called it "Walk Wisely" instead, which is a better Christian title. But it's "Don't Be Stupid." It's really what he's saying here. Because true foolishness is knowing intellectually what is right. It's knowing what I should be doing, but choosing the opposite. It's having all of the resources at my fingertips to make a godly decision and then doing something different. That's foolishness. I think maybe I've told you this story before, but when I was growing up, I played hockey, and our coach, over and over, you know, he would just yell at us incessantly. He would yell at us, "Pass the puck, pass the puck." And we wouldn't pass. We were punk hockey kids, you know. I want to score, you know. We wouldn't pass the puck, and he would grab our face mask of our helmet and pull us over and say, "Pass the puck." And every time we'd roll our eyes and be like, "I know." And he would scream at us, and he would say, "No, you don't know. Because if you knew, you would pass the puck." And he's right. That's what wisdom is. Now, we intellectually knew we should pass the puck, but the wise thing to do is to actually do it. And that's what Paul is talking about here. He's put it into practice. Don't be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Wise acting begins with wise thinking because it moves us to action. And he tells us here, how are we putting this wisdom into place? We're to understand what the will of the Lord is. Now, what he's talking about here is God's moral will. God's commands, his desires for your life and for my life, the way in which we are to live our lives in a way that's honoring to the Lord. He's not saying to understand God's will, find sort of the dot, which shirt you're supposed to wear today, where you're supposed to go to school, which job you're supposed to take, who you're supposed to be around. He's not talking about that. He's talking about God's moral will. Now, there's a lot of ways that we can think about God's will in decision-making, and a really good resource for that is called Decision-Making and the Will of God. It's a book by Gary Friesen, and it's great. It really lays out a biblical pattern for decision-making, and if you're looking for wise ways to make a decision, he lays out a really good pattern. I mean, looking to God's Word, first of all, for what is God's moral will. Because what God does in his word is he prescribes for us, this is my moral will. Stay within this. Trust me. I love you, and I'm telling you what's best. It will go better for you if you stay in here. That's what God's word is for us. That's his moral will. But within that, there's a lot of room. We don't all have the same job. We're not all married to the same person. Thankfully, that would be weird. We don't have all of the same decisions that we're to make, but they all can fit within God's moral will. So first, find out what that is. Look to God's word and find his moral will so you know what parameters you should stay within. And then spend some time praying. God, I have this decision. Should I take this job? Should I take this job? I don't know, Lord. Would you give me some wisdom, some discernment in that? And then get some advice. Scripture says that there's wisdom in a multitude of counselors. So find some people who love you and love the Lord, won't just tell you what you want to hear, but will instruct you in what's best for you. And then make a decision and act. Make the decision. So often we sit there like waffling along, I don't know what to do. Just make a decision. Once you've weighed out the options and you're sure like this fits within God's moral will, there's nothing wrong about that. There are some jobs that you shouldn't take. There are some places that you shouldn't go. But within God's moral will, there's a lot of room there. And so make a decision. And then last, pray that the Lord would close the door if that's not best for you. Just pray. Lord, I'm going to make this decision. I believe it's in keeping with your moral will. I've got some wisdom from some friends, and I think that this is best. But if I'm wrong, just make it clear to me. Listen, that's a prayer that God will answer. When Sarah and I were dating and when we were getting more and more serious, I was like head over heels in love with this woman. I still am. But I was just, this was a prayer that I prayed. Like, Lord, I'm going to marry this woman. I bought the ring. We're gonna do this. But I kept praying, like, Lord, if there's some reason, if there's something I missed, just make it clear to me. Just make it clear to me. And now there's some times that Sarah and I have prayed that about decisions that we have been making, and God has closed a door. He has redirected some things. All right, I guess that wasn't best for us. And the Lord has directed in that, but so often what we need to do is determine God's moral will and then make a decision that's using godly wisdom. God's will for your life isn't some dot that you have to find some secret thing. So if you want more resources, dig into that book. You can look to all of those things. I don't have to understand all of those details. I don't have all of the understanding. I don't have all of the knowledge. But what I can do is seek as much wisdom as possible. And what Paul is talking about here is to discern, to understand what God's moral will is. What are the parameters that we're supposed to live in our lives, to act and to think wisely in this world? And his answer is to understand that, to be thoughtful. It's an idea of learning by experience and examining it. So how do we understand what God's moral will is? It's written right here. You're holding it in your hands. This is God's moral will for you. It actually does not matter what your small group leader says. It matters what this says. It does not matter what you think or what you believe about it even. It matters what it says. It doesn't matter what I'm saying right now. It matters what it says. What does God's will for me say? It's pretty clear. We're giving, 2 Peter says, all things pertaining to life and godliness. Every single situation that you will find yourself in your entire life, this book speaks to it. Oh, it may not tell you whether you should move to Kansas or move to Boston. It may not tell you whether you should marry this guy or that guy. It may not tell you some of the details of those, but it will give you the parameters. Live within this. God is doing it because he loves us and because he wants to instruct us on what his will is. But don't ever claim that you're seeking God's will when your Bible is closed. Don't ever claim, I just wish I heard from the Lord a little more, when your Bible is closed and sitting on a shelf. This is God's will for us. This is God's instruction, and this is wisdom for us. So dig into it. Think wisely, because nothing can take the place of knowing God's word to shape your thinking. This is thinking wisely. And then we're to yield wisely, he says. He gives this example. He says, and do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. Paul here is giving us a specific case of foolishness. And he says it's drunkenness. Put simply, from Paul, drunkenness is foolishness. And he calls it debauchery. It's essentially wastefulness. He's contrasting it with what he just said about making the best use of the time. This debauchery is just wasting it. It's reckless partying consisting of self-indulgence, usually means a life that is fully devoid of all virtue or waste. That's how Paul defines drunkenness. And listen, I know that this is a sensitive topic for believers. I know that's a little touchy, and most of us tend to be on one side or the other. Most people in Christianity will either lean towards legalism, where no Christian should ever drink alcohol, and if you ever do, you're going to hell. Well, that's not what the Bible said. Or they lean towards a license. You know what? Jesus Christ has redeemed me. He's forgiven me. I mean, in Acts, he tells Peter, I've made everything clean, so you can do whatever the heck you want. It's not exactly what the Bible says either. So here's a couple of important things. I just want to be helpful to you through this. The Bible does not tell us that drinking is a sin. It doesn't tell you that. And I'm not going to tell you that either, because I think there's a lot in here about God's moral will, and I don't believe we as Christians should add to that. So I don't believe that drinking is a sin. I don't think God's word says that. However, it does very clearly in many places teach us that drunkenness is a sin. It's a sin. And I think lots of times, a lot of believers that I've talked with, they treat it like drunkenness is, I shouldn't have done that. You know, sort of like when you're in the kitchen and you, like, drop the salt. Oh, man, shoot, I shouldn't have gotten drunk. It's actually something that put Jesus on the cross. And I think we brush over it too lightly a lot of times. That my sin, drunkenness and all these other things that I have participated in, my sin put Jesus on the cross. It's very weighty. So drunkenness clearly is a sin in Scripture. Now, a few other things to note. If you're under 21, it's always a sin. Romans 13 talks about submitting to the authorities. And so if you're under 21, you shouldn't ever drink. I think that's pretty clear from Scripture. If you believe in your conscience that it's wrong for you, then it is wrong for you. Romans 14:23 says, whatever does not proceed from faith is sin. So if you get in that situation, you're like, I think it's probably wrong for me to drink, but I'm going to go ahead and do it. It's sin for you. I'm not saying assign it to somebody else, but for you, it is. Now, for some of you, you feel pretty convicted that you shouldn't drink at all. Man, I shouldn't at all. Okay, then you shouldn't. You should follow that, because whatever does not proceed from faith is sin. And for some of you, alcohol has caused significant problems for you in the past. And you should stay away from it. It would be wise to just steer clear of it. It is not worth it. It's not worth going down a pattern of sinfulness because of some substance. Next, if it causes a brother or sister to stumble, then it's sin. Corinthians talks a ton about this. Romans talks a ton about this. And what that means, it doesn't mean like if a friend of mine thinks it's wrong for him, then it's wrong for me. That's not what that means. I'm not causing my brother to stumble there. If you are pressuring somebody else, if I'm sitting down at dinner and I order a beer and the guy next to me doesn't believe that he should be drinking, but he does because he feels bad, it's sin for me because I'm pressuring him into that. If your abuse of alcohol causes another Christian to doubt or to distress in their faith, then that's sin for you. You're causing a sister or a brother to stumble in their relationship with Jesus, and it's a sin. Now, it can't be a crutch for you. If it's a crutch for you, something that you run to in difficult times, it's a sin. Because only the Lord is who we're to run to. Any substance or person or activity that's like, when things get difficult, I have to have that or I just can't get through it. God wants us to rely on Him alone in difficult seasons. So don't let it be a crutch for you. No substance or activity or person needs to take the place. And ultimately, what Paul is talking about here is it can't have control over you. It can't have control because of the amount. You know, I had a little too much, and so now it's controlling me. And I can't have control because of the frequency. I can't go out and have a good time. I can't hang out with my friends and be with them unless I'm drinking and I've got a little bit of this going on. You're displaying your dependence on it, and it has control over you. Or maybe you won't be drunk, but it has emotional control over you. Now, we don't want to be in legalism, and we don't want to be in license. You have liberty in Jesus Christ to make this decision for yourself. But use it with wisdom. Use it with thankfulness to the Lord. Use it very carefully with wisdom. Because Paul is actually using drunkenness here to explain to us what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. He's pointing back again to making the best use of the time, and that is to be filled with the Holy Spirit. This is it's a passive verb. So it assumes that you don't actually do anything to get it, but you're able to resist it. Like a sail that's filled with wind, I can't fill the sail with wind, but I can make sure the sail is lifted high and open to receive the wind that's there. Now, why does Paul use drunkenness to talk about this? I think they're similar in a couple of ways. One, small decisions that I make lead to it. So I'm out with friends and I have one drink. It's a small decision. And I have another drink, a small decision. And I have another drink. It's beginning to be a pattern in my life, and it's beginning to open the sail to drunkenness to come in. And what Paul is saying here is that our spiritual disciplines are the things that open that sail. They don't save you, but they give you the opportunity to open that sail for the Holy Spirit to fill you. So my ongoing confession of sin and repentance, it's opening the sail. My time spent in God's Word, allowing it to change my thinking, it's opening the sail to be filled with the Holy Spirit. My time in prayer, it's opening the sail to change my will according to what He wants for me. My time in fasting, it's breaking my will of certain things and attuning my heart to desire the Lord more than anything else in this life. These are small steps that can lead us to a willingness to be filled. They're helping us to get the sail up and open to receive what God is going to do in us. So these are small decisions that lead us to a greater place. And then both of these can control us. He's saying drunkenness can have control over you, and the Holy Spirit can have control over you when you allow yourself to be filled with the Holy Spirit. If you've ever been drunk, you've experienced this. It controls you. You make decisions and you do things that you wouldn't do. That's not you. It's the substance controlling you. And in the same way, if you've allowed the Spirit to fill you, you've done and you've said some things that aren't you. Some things that afterwards you can't even believe that that's you. I've been with some people who've been sharing their faith and learning to share the gospel and maybe unsure and a little afraid of what to say, and then get in the moment where they're talking with somebody who doesn't know Jesus Christ and clearly articulate the gospel. And afterwards, people have said so often, like, I didn't even know what I was saying there. It's just like the Lord gave me the words. That's filled with the Spirit. It's opening the sail and allowing Him to fill you and to use you. He's controlling you in that moment. And that is what wise living is. So if you're filled with fear, you're controlled by that. Whatever a person is filled with, they're controlled by that thing. If you're filled with anxiety, if you're filled with sorrow, if you're filled with gratitude, if you're filled with joy, that is the thing that's controlling you. So be filled with the Spirit. That's what it means to have His progressive control over my life. A parallel passage to this is Colossians 3:16, which tells us to let the Word of Christ dwell in us richly. It's God's moral will that's understood from God's word. He continues this text by giving us these examples of what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. What does this even look like, filled with the Holy Spirit? Well, he continues verse 19, filled with the Holy Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. He says, addressing and singing and making melody and giving thanks and submitting. So the way that these function in this sentence structure, they're participles, they're pointing back to filled with the Holy Spirit. Paul's giving us specific examples of what it looks like. These are four disciplines to help us to yield to the Holy Spirit in our life. The first one, he says, is it's fellowship. It's this idea of one another, that we are in this together in this Christian life. And I think never before, like the last year and a half or so, have we needed this. It's about one another. And many of us have experienced even failure over the last year and a half. Maybe you've failed to be that one another to someone else. Maybe you've failed to experience this one another. And for the part that I've played as a pastor, as a small group leader, as a believer, believe me, I'm grieved and deeply sorry for the ways that I've dropped the ball in some of those things. And if you've failed other believers, I hope you are too in examining that. And I hope for better things going forward for us, that we're in this together, that we're seeking after how can we do this one another thing, because none of us were meant to be alone. None of us can be filled with the Spirit on our own. We need a community. We are responsible for one another, for this fellowship. That's what it's calling us to here. So for fellowship and then for worship, he says that we're singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Now, we don't have like a Spotify playlist for what these things were. We don't actually know what their psalms or hymns or spiritual songs were. But what we can tell from the text is that there was a variety in what they sung and listened to. There was a variety in their worship that they're singing to one another and they're singing to the Lord. So we get together on Sundays. We get together, maybe you do it in your small group, and we sing to the Lord and we sing to one another. That we're singing these songs to worship the Lord because he's worth every breath that comes out of me. And that's why we sing to the Lord. But we also sing these songs to increase our faith. We sing these songs to increase the faith of one another. A few minutes ago, we sang the song Waymaker. And maybe you've been through a dark time in your life and you've seen the Lord make a way. You've seen him make a way in the wilderness. You've seen him part the Red Sea before you and change your circumstances. And you can stand here today with arms lifted high and heart joyful, and you can sing that God has made a way. And that's an amazing thing. It stirs up your faith. But there's somebody standing right next to you, maybe a few rows away, who's going through a dark time, who's in the valley right now, who's in the darkness not seeing the light, who's standing here as we sing that song and thinking, can he really make a way through this? And you standing, singing with fervency and faith is stirring up their faith. It's what happens when we read the account of the Red Sea parting. God, you may not be doing it in my life right now, but I know that you've done it. And I can worship you because even if my circumstance isn't changing, I'm praising you that my God isn't changing through the circumstance. And so you standing with faith and fervency in the middle of a dark time for somebody else stirs up their faith. That's how we sing to one another and increase our faith and the faith of our sisters and brothers as we worship together. That's what it means to sing hymns and psalms and spiritual songs to one another, making melody to the Lord with your heart. What's spoken audibly and sung audibly is what comes from your heart. Scripture tells us that out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. So when we stand and we sing, it's not just something that we do to get us in the mood to be together. We're worshiping the Lord and we're stirring one another's faith up as we're together, and we need it each week. It's our worship together and then our gratitude. He says, giving thanks always and for everything. And that's the hard part. Always and for everything. We have this new vertical worship song where the chorus is, with everything, for everything, thank you, Jesus. There's some things that are harder to thank the Lord for than others, and I confess that I'm working on this. Some things are really easy, and I'm working really hard on just giving thanks to the Lord each and every week for these things, but there's some other things that I'm giving thanks to the Lord because I believe that he will use it at some point. And wherever you're at in that, gratitude is a discipline. It's a decision that we make to thank the Lord always and for everything. And it's a way that we yield to the Holy Spirit. And then fourthly, through submission. He says, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. It's voluntarily yielding myself to another person out of love for them. It has nothing to do with equality. It has everything to do with love and a decision that I make. And why is it done? Why does Paul say it's done? It's done out of reverence for Christ, out of respect for Jesus, out of worship for Him. That's why we submit to one another. And in the weeks to come, we're going to be talking and looking at what Paul talks about some of these relationships that God calls us to live in submission to one another out of reverence for Christ. But these disciplines, if you aren't doing these things, if you're falling short in these things, for sure, ask the Lord to give you the strength. But the answer to each of these is to open the sail. It's to be more receptive to the Spirit's leading, to be available for the Spirit to lead us. It's not a try harder, do better, you just need more this week. It's a submission to the Holy Spirit. It's opening the sail. It's releasing control of your life and saying, Holy Spirit, fill me, control me, give me wisdom this week to live in a way that honors you, that lives in the light of who I am in Jesus Christ. So the question for us today is, are you on this path of wise living? Are you living with foolishness? Are you living with God's wisdom? Are you looking carefully with how you would walk? Not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of every day. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for your perfect wisdom that you give us from your word. We are grateful for the way that you so perfectly lead us, that you give us direction in every aspect of our lives. And Father, we thank you that you have called us into a community. We pray that you would have us to live with this wisdom with one another. God, allow us to relinquish control this week for the one whose hands are gripped tightly around their lives. Let them release it to you, submitting it to you, Holy Spirit. Father, for the one that's filled with bad decisions, allow them to look carefully at each of those and to choose wise things in maturity to follow you. Father, for the one who's overcome with grief and that is what's controlling, would you release them from that? Allow them to be filled with your Spirit. Father, for the one who's overcome with anxiety, allow them to let that go this week, to release it to you. Only you can work in it, Lord. Holy Spirit, would you fill our sails? Holy Spirit, would you allow us to be used by you to take every single day as a perfect opportunity to live for you, to make a mark for Jesus Christ out of the foundation that you've built us upon. Allow us to build our lives with gold and silver and precious stones, that you would use us to display your beauty and your perfect wisdom in this world. Use us, God, for your glory and for your purposes, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.